APA advanced pricing agreement, which is to do with transfer pricing cases, whereas AVR advanced tax ruling that can be in fact any other ruling that can be available, for example, case the participation when you speak with a tax lawyer about a ruling, you'll always hear that a ruling is about granting legal certainty. And you always hear taxpayers don't like uncertainty because otherwise we will not do the investment. So it's great if you know tax attorneys, if you know the case, and ask about what is often forgotten is that, of course, tax rulings can also be used to give a little benefit to the taxpayer. Because maybe it would be interesting for the state to have Starbucks investing in the Netherlands. Maybe it would be interesting if Ireland and Apple building its offices in Cork, in Ireland. So we are constantly dealing with, on the one hand, legal certainty, and on the other hand, maybe granting benefits. As I said, I think it's important to keep in mind, most people working in the tax field consider a ruling is only about legal certainty. So they only see the first part of the issue, and they simply look at the fact that a ruling concerns about why is this so interesting, this topic? Because today we will see the impact of state aid law on this issue. And then we will see that granting a ruling in accordance with law can no longer be done so only, I'm going to speak Italian, and English now as well, that's the beginning. Granting a ruling should also consider EU law. This is also part of the relevant laws that should be taken into consideration. So we have the national part and the EU part. Why is this so relevant and important? Well, this morning we already spoke about it. When it comes to state aid law, in the case law of Court of Justice concerning legitimate expectation, it became clear that in the EU perspective, state aid is always a tandem, a cooperation between states and governments if they have the same interest. And of course, with rulings, yeah, that's also clear. Of course, a ruling gives legal certainty, and that's basically what it's about in most of the cases. But of course, a ruling can also be a very good instrument to give a little bit of aid, to give a little bit of advantages. So there is a different point. It's important to keep in mind that what we are dealing with here concerns the discretionary powers of the tax authorities. We are constantly, because state aid can also be about the legislator who is granting, like this morning, the coordination center, who is granting benefits through its legislation. Here, we speak about discretionary power of the tax authorities who need to have a look at that tax ruling. And it's important to keep in mind that it's not completely new, this state aid research of discretionary power. If we look, for example, of this case from Finland, E-Oil, I think you should say oil, loss deductions in Finland, and the tax authorities had to agree, had to apply the law concerning the amount of losses that could be carried. came up, whether that practice was maybe a problem of state. And there the Court of Justice ruled that the application of that system to calculate the losses can in principle considered to be selective if the authorities, when deciding on the application for authorization, have only a degree of latitude limited by objective criteria which are not unrelated to the tax system established by the legislation in question. However, if they have a broad discretion to determine the beneficiaries for the conditions for which the system is provided, on the basis of criteria unrelated to the tax system, the exercise of that discretion must be regarded as favoring undertakings or companies. What we see there is that it is acceptable, it is understandable that authorities have some discretion and power. That's okay, but if they use it, they must use that power in a way that they are bound by objective criteria which are not unrelated to the tax system established by the legislation itself. So, granting that authorization of the losses should be based on criteria that are relevant as laid down in the law and not simply you do what you like, to put it that way. So this judgment already shows a bit how the Court of Justice thinks about this topic. You could say, on the basis of this case, you could say, well, it's okay to grant tax rulings, but you need to have proper rules in your legislation, which make clear on the basis of what criteria you grant those rulings. Well, that's an example, a recent case, which is making clear that it's already a relevant issue. In the decision practice of the European Commission, you see more cases concerning discretionary power of the tax authorities. An interesting one, which my colleague Peter Essen in Tilburg wrote an entire book, is the so-called Technologies case. It's a very complicated structure involving Philips, the Netherlands, and the Rabobank Bank, and the Dutch government. And while they were agreeing on a sale and lease back transaction, and in the end, it concerned whether or not the question was whether the losses that were there could be utilized with the help of that transaction. It was very simple. And there, that was in 2000, the European Commission said, well, look, and everything is granted in accordance with Dutch rules. So there it found a problem, whereas my colleague, when he had a look now, Peter Essens, has some doubts whether this was all.
Was it not about the object of the sale and the reality of the object of the sale that they sell? Immaterial property?
Yeah, that was the sale, that was part of the problem, but in the end it had also, it had to do with loss utilization.
Yeah, yeah.
Whether, because they had a lot of unused losses and whether they could be absorbed in this particular case. Yeah, and it was quite at the borders of the moment, to put it that way, to apply this situation. And there the European Commission had a look at their data. Found out as they believe that it was not stated in this particular case. As I said, having a look at tax rulings is not something new in the sense that the European Commission in its 1998 notice, as you know, then it was the first time that they gave a notice on how to apply the state aid rules in matters of direct taxation. That was in 1998, after the Code of Conduct, which we spoke about this morning. And there it was written that, of course, tax rules need to be interpreted. They cannot leave room for discretionary treatment of undertaking. There we go. Every decision of the administration that departs from general tax rules to the benefit of individual undertakings, the principle leads to the presumption of state aid. So that's even, I would say, even stronger. If we only start with a different interpretation, there it could already be problematic, and therefore it should be analyzed in detail. And then they say, as far as they contain only interpretation of the general rules, they should they do not give rise to the presumption of aid. And then in the end, the European Commission wrote, but however, in the end, it should still be possible to make use of tax rulings to grant legal certainty to the taxpayers. But there, already in 1998, it became clear that the European Commission was maybe considering to have a look at it, and it was already considering that it could be a problem, and even so strongly that it says that if a decision of the administration departs from the general tax rules, there is the presumption of aid. That was in 1998. In the meantime, we had an economic and financial crisis. In the meantime, it became clear that harmful tax competition is maybe a bigger and bigger problem. The European Commission started to have a more critical look on tax rulings, started in 2013 to investigate all those big name cases. And what we see is that in 2016 they released the new notice on the notion of state aid with a lot of detail on fiscal state aid, how to apply the state aid rules in matters of taxation. And there we also see an entire section dedicated to the problem of tax rulings. And there they do the other way around. So in 1998 they started with, could be problematic, but in the end they said, but you should still be able to use tax rulings to give legal certainty. Here we see the first thing they say, section 160, paragraph 169, granting of tax rulings to give legal certainty is acceptable, it's okay. It's important also for business life to get legal certainty so that they can invest in the way that they find appropriate. But there are a few situations where they become quite strict. Tax rulings confer a selected advantage on their addressees in particular, and then they distinguish three different situations. Situation one, the tax ruling misapplies national tax law, and this results in a lower amount of tax. So here we speak about application of the law, and when it's applied incorrectly, there it would be a matter of a selective advantage. And if you look at the French case, GDF Suez, there they are in fact invoking this argument, misapplication of the law. Question is, how much misapplication do we need? Are we going to contra legem application, or is it just a matter of not within the lines that are acceptable? That's not so clear, I think. That's one issue. Then the second one, they say the ruling is not available to undertakings in similar legal and factual situations. The example that came in my mind when I read this is the case which became public after a lot of difficulties. There was a big company in the US called Walt Disney, And they wanted to open a park in Paris. Great, we can all go to, well, this in Europe. They went to the French authorities. Hello, we are Walt Disney and we would like to open a park here in Paris. What can we do? In the end, it became published that a tax ruling was agreed on a very favorable treatment for that park, the profits made by that park in Paris. That ruling was only available to the particular taxpayer because France was happy to have that park within the Paris jurisdiction. Any other taxpayer probably would not have got that. Here we see the element of granting benefits to the taxpayer becoming. Then the third one, the administration applies a more favorable tax treatment compared with other taxpayers in a similar factual and legal situation. And that's what we are speaking about in most of those cases concerning transfer price, where the European Commission takes the argument that, for example, Starbucks is allowed to use a certain transfer pricing methodology, which gives a certain allocation of the profits, whereas, in fact, that profit allocation, that particular methodology, give benefit to startups, because other situations wouldn't have been the application of the complicated transactional net margin method, but maybe we would have found a third methodology, simply the price that is available on the market, whereas instead of the complicated calculation with the help of the transactional net margin methodology. So, and there of course we see the development of the overall language of the EU, which I come back in a little bit later. Or, and that's in fact related to that, and that's in fact in the ruling, more indirect methods are being used. That's the other thing that they agree about. And then interestingly, in 2016, another working paper of the European Commission, they say, well, we only consider problematic those tax rulings which are manifest errors. Tax rulings that are so clearly not in agreement with the arm's length principle that we had to consider them as a selective advantage. And for example, that could be when there is no proper documentation. So we have made a ruling, and usually, as we all know, there has to be a lot of documentation for transfer pricing. But when such documentation is rather limited, and there is still the ruling, there is something wrong. That's an indication that there is something wrong. So that's how the European Commission looks at it. And in this way, we are stuck with those guidelines which give also rise to multiple interpretations. I would say, how should we interpret those guidelines of the European Commission, especially because they have their own inflation, I mean. But what happened then is that they started to investigate a lot of tax rulings, and what happened was it is known that for a longer period they were already asking information from the states about tax rulings, but many cases became public. For example, the Apple case, there was the hearing in the United States about how Apple was being treated and then their beneficial treatment, and then the European Commission decided to initiate those investigations into those tax rulings. And what we see there is that if you look at those cases, they all concern the taxation of multinational companies, They all concern taxpayers with group companies in a lot of different jurisdictions, and they were all big names, of course, that's also clear, but what we see there is all the time, in fact, the European Commission considers the problem that as a group of companies, as a multinational group, you have certain benefits that are not there, but you are standalone taxpayer. And, well, at university we always learn, we all learn that of course there are fundamental differences between being a group company and a standalone company, and therefore they deserve different treatment in tax law. But of course it's also true that being a group of companies, you have a lot of benefits. The excess profit rules in Belgium are made on that. You have, as a multinational company, you create benefits that you wouldn't be able to make if you would be operating on your own. And the question is, those extra benefits, where should they be taxed? How should they be taxed? And in all these cases, we see that, in fact, the companies found a way to have their income taxed at a low rate, maybe, or in the Apple case, if you disappear in the ocean, a stateless income. And the European Commission seems to be targeting that particular problem, and in fact, arguing that group companies are not so different from individual companies. Whereas legislation is not difficult, but they are different, but they are challenging. Moreover, we also see that in all these cases, we see tax authorities blessing tax planning structures. We see situations where taxpayers take advantage of the fact that there is no harmonized tax system. They make up a structure which may be perfectly legal in all relevant jurisdictions, so nothing wrong with that. But if you look at the big picture, you may wonder, is that desirable? Even more, you may wonder, is it desirable that the state grants blessing to a ruling of which it is clear that the taxpayer is in fact taking advantage of the differences that we have? And isn't it the fact that in this way states are in fact fueling tax competition? They are getting in the competition and make the situation maybe even worse. And that's maybe what the European Commission is trying to challenge. Well, if we then have a look, we see already a few final decisions of the European Commission in individual tax rulings. Yeah, Starbucks already learned. Apple, Amazon, and they all concern rulings as such. It is an agreement between that taxpayer and that state. Whereas in the Belgian case, the excess profit exemption case, it was not so much a particular ruling that was being challenged, but the system as such, giving advantages to those companies. And there you mean that that system as such grants selective advantages to taxpayers, and then in the end you claim that at least 35, which you may know better, 35 companies have concluded such a ruling, and they have to repay, but that's also paying now. We see that, and the European Commission said that explicitly in the press release, that they looked at transfer prices which do not reflect economic reality, and that's for example in the Starbucks case. They look at profit allocation methods which do not reflect economic reality. That's in the Apple case, because the Apple case is about allocation of profit between head office and permanent establishment. And inconsistent application of national law giving rise to discretionary double normal taxation. In other words, like in the McDonald's case, which is still pending, should a state, in this case Luxembourg, grant a tax ruling if it knows that the taxpayer, with the help of that ruling, is taking benefit of the fact that the Luxembourg tax system and the US tax system give a different interpretation to that particular fact, so that double non-taxation is resulted? Well, that's in a very broad way, and as I said, there are still cases pending. We know about the laws in the US and recently also IKEA. Also know, but it's also clear that they are investigating a lot of other cases. And the question is whether that will result in formal investigations. Well, I couldn't resist to, but I, given the time, I should be brief.
Can I?
Yeah, sure. We're going to have a look at that situation, and then of course there is a decision, and that's how we know. But
do we also know about
it? I don't know. No, that's why I'm quite sure that they are also considering other situations, because they get claims from competitors, as we know, but mostly because they have asked all member states to give information about their rulings. And that's, I think it's a problem which you are rightly observing. We do not know enough. And that's a problem for legitimate expectations, because maybe, yeah, they have already had a look at my case, and I didn't know that they did. How should I think about it? So there is a certain secrecy, I would say, which is
maybe. But every year, yeah, there is a publication of the official journal of the EU of the measure which has been notified.
Yeah, that's true, but we don't know whether they are investigating rulings that are
beforehand.
Yeah, and that's a problem. Well, if we then have a look, because I said I speak about procedural problems substantively. First of all, we have more harmonized taxation systems. So the sovereignty of the states makes sure that the states can still do their own thing. But on the other hand, we are increasingly relying on international soft law norms, like the OECD transfer pricing guidelines. And speaking about discretionary power for the tax authorities, those guidelines, as we always say, transfer pricing is number one, it's not science. There is always a margin. How should we interpret that margin when we have to consider whether they stated it in the agreement? The margin is inherent to the norm. Moreover, there are differences between. Well, then there are these disparities between taxing systems, which give possibilities for taxpayers to take advantage of it. But the issue is that if we want to apply fiscal state law to this national taxing systems, we see on the one hand that state aid law is still not so clear. There are still a lot of difficulties about the scope of fiscal state aid law. For example, in the end, when you have to consider a situation, whether it's incompatible with aid or not, everything boils down to the selectivity analysis, which is still very unclear. So we do not know how to interpret that selectivity analysis, and how to interpret those cases, for example, the comparability between group companies and independent companies. Fiscal doctrine always considers them different, but maybe fiscal, the state aid law, has the effect that they are more comparable. That makes it difficult to apply at this moment. Should state aid law deal with harmful tax competition or not? It's a question that we are considering now. Moreover, as we saw this morning, the European Commission has a lot of power to develop its own state aid policy, And therefore, we see that it's going step by step a little bit further in the application of state aid law. And therefore, we see that this autonomous arm's length principle, which is in fact a market equality principle, has been developed. But yeah, how should we interpret that manifest errors which I was speaking about? How should we know about it? And in the end, we see that the European Commission would go on like this, in fact, become like a watchdog, overlooking the activities of all the national governments, the national authorities, and yeah, doesn't have its position to do so, doesn't have legitimacy to do so, especially when the criteria are still not so clear. So with this particular slide, I wanted to make it clear that in order to speak about these textual cases, we have to deal with many uncertainties which make it difficult for all you, I think, to apply it in case you are asked. Because there are still a lot of unknown facts. Well, if you have any questions, please do ask. I want to have a brief look at the pending cases. We start with the Apple case. Apple case is of course the most famous case. It also concerns the biggest amount, 30 billion, which in the meantime has already been put on an escrow account, so like we spoke about this morning, so it's temporary already safe. And the Apple case, well, there was a negative decision on August 2016. Ireland was told to recover the aid. But interestingly, in this case, Ireland didn't do that. They were particularly slow with the recovery. And there we see that the Court of the European Commission brought that case already to the Court of Justice to ask and to force Ireland to recover that aid. So there we immediately see how the European Commission can react if you do not take action as you are supposed to do. And then of course there are cases pending before the General Court. Ireland started the case against the Commission and also Apple did. So they brought the cases before the General Court to see whether the court would agree with the decision of the European Commission. And it's important, I think, to from a substantive point of view, that this case is clearly a very aggressive tax planning, although I don't like to use that word. But what Apple did is that those excess profits, to put them that way, they were not even put in a tax haven, but in no haven at all. That income was stateless. It was simply going in the globe, where without any particular allocation to a particular state, it was possible because of an Irish law which has been repealed in the meantime. But it shows that in this case, there are so many disparities in international tax law that Apple could make use of that situation. At the same time, I wonder, okay, where should that income have been allocated then? Is it part of, should Ireland be taxing it as Commission is claiming, or maybe it should be somewhere else? That's one thing. The other one, Starbucks. Well, we already spoke about that this morning. What is interesting to tell is the decision of 2015. There are also two cases pending before the General Court, Netherlands versus Commission and Starbucks itself. What is interesting to note is that since a few years, the European Commission has got more power to investigate situations. And here they make use of that power because apparently they were not happy about the information that was given by the banks about the food, about how those prices were being determined. And now they have the power to ask competitors about information about those prices. And what happened in the decision, you see that the European Commission is relying on information from unknown competitors who give information about the price that they would be using in these particular conditions. This case that I mentioned there, in brackets, State Bestuur versus European Commission, is a case in which this man tried to force the European Commission to give information about where that information came from. Who told them that the price of Starbucks were not maybe market compatible? Somebody else told them.
And who was Stephen
Fisher? Well, that's what I wanted to tell you. Because this man happens to be the lawyer of Starbucks. Okay. So he had a certain interest to gather this information. I found it probably there is no difficulty, you can just do that, but I think it would have been a little bit more transparent if that was a little bit clearer in that case. But in the end, the General Court dismissed his claims and simply stated that it's the right of the European Commission to make use of that anonymous information if they don't get proper information from the member state. So I thought it was interesting to mention that particular issue. Well, Fiat, that concerns a case in Luxembourg. I think for the sake of time, I will briefly deal with that there. And then finally in Belgium, we already spoke about the what's interesting there, of course, is that there is this, well, it's in Belgium, I mean, you say there, Belgium should be covered from various recipients. So it's not just one taxpayer like Starbucks, but a lot. Consequently, you would say that all these taxpayers would go to the General Court to fight that decision, because they are affected by it and they would have the possibility to do so. Well, I heard that there would be 35 taxpayers, but if I counted the number of pending cases, it's not 35. So I think not all taxpayers have taken the opportunity to go to the General Court. And we will see later that, in my view, that will affect their position in National Court, because if they don't go themselves the highest court, they cannot in national court claim, yeah, well, I didn't go to the European Court of Justice in the end, but I would like you, dear judge, to grant my legitimate expectation that I will be able to play. So I think that's important to mention. I don't know if you have any. Okay. Well, then, as I told you, I thought, given the topic, it's interesting to consider what arguments are being used concerning legitimate expectation. And I have learned that I shouldn't put too much text on slides. I can tell you here I failed very much. But it's mostly because I thought maybe at home you will be reading it and then you have an overview. I will also not deal with all the slides that I have prepared, but just to give you an idea what we are speaking about. If we start with Apple, and I just stand here so you can all read it a little bit better. These are positions taken by both Apple and Ireland. And later I will show you what the European Commission reacted to that. This simply comes from the decision, paragraph 439. Ireland and Apple raised the argument that by opening the formal investigation procedure and calling into doubt 22 years later the state aid compliance of the two rulings, Commission has violated the principle of legal certainty. According to Ireland, rules, state aid rules, must be predictable, and the Commission is not entitled to develop union law by extending the boundaries of those rules in a novel way by reference to international developments like the OECD framework. So that's the argument, you're doing something completely new. Then it's important to know that Ireland in the 1980s did not apply the international arm's length principle. It did not apply the OECD transfer pricing guidelines. They were quite free there in Ireland. And the claim is made that by applying the arm's length principle, the Commission is retrospectively imposing an external reference framework that was not part of domestic Irish law. Ireland had its own transfer pricing principles, its own relatively relaxed ways of calculating intercompany prices. And they say, now suddenly they make use of those international guidelines, which we never had. How can you do that? Well, according to case law until now, it has always been the case that states are completely free, given their sovereignty, to develop their own taxing system, and that functions as the benchmark. So if you make a very beneficial treatment which applies to anything and everybody, it's no selective state aid. And here, therefore, they were also allowed to deviate from international norms. And this is exactly the point which caused so much discussion, because that was the way it was always applied, and now suddenly the EU started to invoke international norms which deviated from those national norms, and that caused a lot of consternation about whether that was applicable. I can, from a normative point of view, I can completely understand your position, but this is how it was always being considered. Yeah.
But I think it's also important to emphasize that the Commission used a very important and tricky position, because in fact the court is saying that the Commission is saying that the arm's length principle is included in Article 107, Paragraph 1, and therefore there cannot be benchmark because there is direct application.
See, yeah. Now we come back to that.
It is a defensible argument.
It is, to the extent that it is proved that in Article 107 there is actually an arm's length, which I think the Commission doesn't do in their decisions. It simply takes for granted that selectivity, in a way or another, is a guarantee that there is an arm's length principle, but it is not given an interpretation that proves that there is arm's length principle, which is very much more specific than selectivity. So the proof that the selectivity contains an arm's length principle is not given at all by the Commission. So the legal reasoning can be correct, it certainly can be correct, but to the extent that it's proved that Article 107 actually contains an arm's length principle. And further, it must be proved that the arm's length principle contained in Article 107 is the same that the arm's length principle contained in Article 9 of the OECD. And then I can accept that the guidelines are applied. But this is not proved at all in the decisions.
Ireland argues that the Commission's retroactive application of today's principles means that Ireland is being held to a standard that Apple could not have anticipated when the rulings were issued. So here again you see that there is a completely novel analysis. Those were the arguments that were being used. Well, here a lot of information about what this Commission in the end argues. Look at the second bullet point. Commission is responding to the fact that it says, yeah, well, those rulings, they were never notified to the Commission. or otherwise publicly available, and the commission could only have learned the existence of those rulings when they were publicly disclosed. So that argument doesn't fly, as we saw this morning. They started immediately to investigate the situation, but since those rulings were secret, and nobody could have known before that maybe they were granting state aid through these rulings. Furthermore, then it says that as soon as they knew about it, they took action. So that's the last point. This one I thought I'd skip for the second. Because here we go to the legitimate expectations. A member state whose authorities have granted aid in breach of Article 108(3) may not plead legitimate expectations of a recipient to justify a failure to comply with the obligation to take the steps necessary to implement a commission decision instructing it to recover the aid. So here we see that if you didn't do anything as a member state, you cannot invoke legitimate expectations anymore. I think that's what we spoke about this morning.
That the member state cannot supply legitimate expectations for the benefit.
Yeah, for the benefit indeed. I'm sorry. Yeah, I was a little bit. And then it says, well, since Apple didn't do anything during those proceedings, we cannot take into consideration the arguments, but we will take a look at the arguments of Ireland as if they were arguments of Apple. Well, and then they continue with the novelty of the approach. And then they say, interestingly, on the third point, the Commission identified tax rulings as fiscal measures capable of giving rise to state aid in its 1999 notice on the application of state aid rules, as I explained before, and therefore it's not something new. A diligent taxpayer could have known that tax rulings could be investigated ever since 1998. And therefore they cannot invoke these arguments. Well, this was just to give you a bit of an overview of these arguments. I don't want to spend too much time on it. If we then see that in the end, in the proceedings pending before the General Court, we see that those arguments are coming back. Ireland is referring again to legitimate expectations, and it also says that they are using a reference framework existing in 2010, the OECD transfer pricing guidelines, whereas at the time the ruling was being concluded, Ireland had its own legislation, so they could never have expected that that argument was going to be taken. Well, and Apple also took that argument, so we will see how the General Court will eventually consider these arguments when it is deciding on the compatibility of those measures. Sorry. Mostly yes. Well, then in the Starbucks case, I already mentioned that this morning. Neither in the proceedings during the investigation of the commission, but also not now in the pending case before the General Court, Starbucks made any claims concerning legitimate expectations. You see that the European Commission writes only the NOB, that's the Dutch Order of Tax Advisors. They said something about legitimate expectations, but they also couldn't say anything where those expectations were built on. So the European Commission simply dismisses that argument, and Starbucks doesn't rely on it anymore. In the Fiat case, comparable arguments, but there we also see, and I want to come back to that a bit later, they say that the EU Code of Conduct group, which is a political instrument to check harmful tax practices, has approved the ruling practice in Luxembourg. So, Code of Conduct Group is a group of regulated by a member state, in the end by the council, which checks whether there is harmful tax competition in the various states. And there, that ruling practice was approved. And now Luxembourg is making our council in the end approved that ruling practice. So we can rely on the fact that for state aid purposes it was accepted. And therefore we have legitimate expectations that we can make that we can rely on this ruling that it was acceptable. We cannot have any more now the case that it would be unacceptable. But that I will come back to a bit later. The European Commission dismisses the argument very simply. And in the Belgium case, here we see that reference is being made to that Forum 187 case, where reference is being made to the fact that previous Commission decisions on transfer pricing have led Belgium to believe that there can be no state aid if a member state adheres to the arm's length principle, considering that there is no harmonization. So, in that case, the Court of Justice gave some kind of indication that the arm's length principle would be acceptable, and then they say, well, we make use of the arm's length principle, which in the end that was embedded in that excess profit rule, in a way or another. You a little smile, they say, therefore, we can rely on that. And then they also speak about the Code of Conduct Group, because the Code of Conduct Group also had a look at informal capital rulings, which I understood were like a predecessor to that excess profit regime. And they said, well, that was accepted by then, and now 10 years later, you start with objections about our excess profit regime. So we also claim that we could have relied on the fact that it would be no state aid. And also there, the European Commission dismisses the claims, and now cases are pending before the court, for the general court. Then we should have a look whether those arguments have any chance of success before the general court, and maybe they can go to the national court. Well, here I have made a little summary of what Carla discussed this morning. A beneficiary can claim different expectations, but he must meet a few conditions. There must be an assurance of plans measures compatibility with the internal market given by an EU institution and not by a member state. Even the most prudent and diligent market operators would not have been able to foresee the adverse change of his or her legal situation. And when we would make a comparison between public and private interest, it would be clear that in this case the private interest weighs more heavily than the public interest, and therefore legitimate expectations should be claimed. Well, what I want to do then is to research this first question about an assurance of measures compatibility given by an institution, checking whether there is previous approval by the European Commission, whether there are positive decisions equivalent cases, whether there is a previous assessment of the European Commission, or whether there has been a failure to act the European Commission, because all of these can be situations that could give rise to this particular situation. Well, can we say that there has been previous approval by the European Commission? So I would say that there is, in all these cases, there is no previous approval. You could wonder, and in fact that was your question, could we say that the approval by the Council of the findings of the Code of Conduct would count as a previous approval of an EU institution, because of course the council is also an EU institution and reference is always made to EU institutions. Well, in that forum 187 versus Belgium, which was the commission case, which Carlos spoke about this morning, the Court of Justice dismissed the argument, simply said that the council expresses an aspiration of a political nature and can therefore not produce legal effects on which parties could rely before the court. So that's a bit strange to some extent, I would say. I do completely understand the different nature of the code of conduct group and the more hard law of state aid law, but yeah, I could imagine that also assurances given by the council could maybe give this indication. I don't know if you would agree with me. I mean, I do get it, but in the end, it's very narrow. It should be approval by the European Commission, the EU institution, and not any other institution.
I think it can depend on how, in which role the council acts. Because, for example, the council has also the possibility, so it has some competence in terms of evaluating the compatibility of a certain measure. So it depends on what kind of political act is taken, if it's political or if it's not political.
You know, previous approval by the European Commission. Would there be positive decisions in equivalent cases? This was important in, for example, the coordination case we spoke about this morning, because there was this reference to the 1984 case. And in fact, in that period, the European Commission decided on many other harmful tax measures, like, for example, the Dutch 15b, Article 15b regime. And there also reference was made to decisions from 1984 that became like a holy grail of legitimate expectations, that decision. I would say that here, in this case, we cannot also find any equivalent decision which would give you an assurance that such rulings would be acceptable. I would find it hard. You could only say maybe that in the past there was already this legitimate expectation that certain of these harmful tax measures could be acceptable if they were not applied after the decision or something like that, but that would be a very difficult argument to make. So I would say that this also does not apply. So here we don't have anything. Could we say that a previous assessment by the European Commission could give you such an assurance? Well, point of course that we know very little about what they've been doing. That's what you said before. So if we don't know what they are doing, it's very difficult to get any assurance that maybe they have been already investigating my ruling, that it would have been acceptable or not. So that would be difficult. To the contrary, you could even say, well, we know from the past that they look into tax rulings on the basis of that 1998 notice, and we know that it can be problematic if there is too much leeway for the tax authorities, which gives the possibility to grant selective advantages. And yeah, we also know that in the past, the European Commission investigated harmful tax practices. So also here, I find it difficult to see how this could give an assurance that it would be acceptable. But please let me know if you see any other arguments. Then, could we say, that's the final argument that could be raised, that the European Commission never took proper action, because they maybe already could have known a little bit about such rulings, but they never did anything about it, and therefore they failed to act, and therefore we as taxpayers would have a legitimate expectation that the ruling would be acceptable. Now, as we saw this morning, the case law on this particular point is not so clear. We have only one case where such inaction has been granted. And of course, we also know that this ruling is that they were secret. So how could the European Commission could have taken action?
And also that just the evolution of time and ideas, and also the court cases of the Panama Papers and Liechtenstein, mm-hmm. and all those paradises increases the perception of the evolution of the interpretation of those. Because I strongly believe that the European Commission didn't know about the preference.
Even if we could argue that they didn't do nothing, it's also because of a changed period, a changed environment. Maybe you could claim, I'm just trying to find arguments that could lead to the fact that there has been a failure to act. Maybe they did not approve individual rulings as such, like the ruling between Starbucks and the Netherlands. But they did know about the ruling practice. They did know what rules were in place to grant a ruling. So we know the rules of the rulings. And that's also what you read in Dutch literature, for example. In the Netherlands, we changed the ruling practice in 2001 under international pressure. European Commission could have known about that. And therefore, they, from the fact that they never really took action, we could take the expectation that the individual ruling to Starbucks would have been acceptable. I find this a difficult argument to make, but you read it in literature, people try to find a solution. I don't know if you would agree with them. And then the last question, what should a prudent, what should the most prudent and diligent taxpayer do when the state does not notify the aid? There, it's an important point. There is the Alcan case, which I will not explain in great detail, but can we say in that case the Court of Justice actually attributed the responsibility of the state to notify aid to the taxpayer? So the taxpayer cannot rely on that. We see again the merging of interests of the taxpayer and the state, and it's not up to the taxpayer to claim that the state should have done something. So he cannot build any confidence from that argument. Well, I will come back to that in a second, because here maybe I would see in the end a little bit of room maybe to be a little bit less strict about legitimate expectations, because of course, what could a taxpayer do when you have a ruling? What are the possibilities? This morning we already discussed. All you can do is ask information from the European Commission maybe to understand whether or not you have been granted the ruling that was a state aid. For the rest, it's not so much you could do. So maybe there would be a failure to act, but it's a difficult argument to make. So here, since it's accumulation, in fact, that needs to be a failure to act, and you need to have acted very prudent and diligent, it's already difficult to make the claim, because there has been no assurance from the EU. Well, if we then go to the second question, and I'll try... Oh no, it works again. Well, even the most prudent and diligent market operator could not have been able to foresee a first change in his or her legal situation. That's the second argument that we have to consider. And well, of course, from a procedural point of view, there is no need to discuss very long, because I mean, the should have simply checked whether it was notified, etc. In that way, there is no leeway there at all. Notably, you could ask, well, should they have been more careful? And maybe, as a taxpayer, you can tell your tax advisor that he should have told you better about a ruling. But, well, that doesn't really help me here to claim a different expectation. But that's more the lack of knowledge that still is there about how to apply fiscal state aid. What's maybe the most interesting question from a legal point of view about these ruling cases is that we should consider whether this argument could be extended a little bit and to say, well, could a very prudent, I just use another word now, a very prudent and diligent taxpayer have known that such a problem would exist in the future about this ruling? So that's not so much a procedural point, but more a substantive point of view. In fact, this morning we also spoke about that. Yeah. How could you know that maybe in the future the rules for state aid would be changing? And that's also what you see in the arguments made by, for example, Apple. The novelty of the legal analysis of the European Commission should that be taken into consideration. It was far from obvious that the rulings would constitute state aid. So how then could we have expected, even if we are very diligent, that this was going to happen? Also because the case law of the courts on fiscal state aid is still in development. It's still, as I said before. So, well, the question is, should maybe here we grant an opportunity to the taxpayer to have an argument that it could have had a different expectation because we are doing something too new, something too in development. And I think it's important, that's how I like to approach such problems, first to understand why do we have this extremely restrictive approach towards legitimate expectations? Why is that? Well, this morning we already spoke about that, of course. In EU law, with respect to state aid, the interests of the taxpayer and the state are considered to be the same, and it's up to the European Commission to break that. So therefore, it cannot be that duo, the state and the taxpayer, can have a look at each other and say, well, I'm going to come to you, you're going to come to me. That's not possible. So it should be very strict because they have a shared interest to block the recovery in the end. And that's what we always tend to see, that they try to help each other to block the recovery. Partners in crime, in a way. Moreover, they could also be said to have a shared interest to grant the aid. If we think of the solution of the case that Mercedes in Germany would be going bankrupt, it's in the interest of Mercedes to get money from the German government, and Germany is also having that Mercedes can continue activities in Germany. So also for both of them there is this shared interest to give the aid. Therefore, we should be extremely strict with regard to legitimate expectations because here they have the same views. And if we then would apply that view towards the tax ruling cases, we see in fact the problem coming back again because the very fact that taxpayers and states have shared interests explains why the public is wary about tax rulings because they could be an effective way to grant some benefits to the taxpayers. So, I think for that reason maybe that argument shouldn't be changed because especially with regard to the rulings, we see this special relationship coming back, and it's exactly what we are trying to target here. So maybe that would not be a way to extend it. Maybe then the argument, that was completely novel legal analysis that was unpredictable. Maybe that would be an argument to count on legitimate expectations. And there we see, and you read that in literature dealing with this, although very little is written about it, that as a businessman, also a diligent businessman, you are forward looking. You look at what's going to happen, and you cannot maybe predict that this kind of development would have been there. And there it's interesting, if I saw on the website of the European Commission, in which they explain all these cases, they say, the Commission in the past has adopted numerous decisions on tax planning practices, which provide precedence in the ongoing investigations. Well, I think that's a little bit too much to claim, in my view. Of course, there have been numerous decisions in harmful tax competition issues, like coordination centers, the Dutch provisions, but to say that there are precedents in tax planning practices, I have difficulties to agree with that. And then there is again that one case, because in fact the Belgium and Forum 187 case is quite a crucial case for the time, because it's one of the few things we have actually to count on. And interestingly, the European Commission counts on one particular paragraph of that decision of the Court of Justice as the foundation for its EU arm's length principle. And I just want to read it to you. It's paragraph 95. There the Court of Justice says, the Belgian special regime, which we spoke about this morning, should be compared with the ordinary tax system based on the difference between profits and outgoings of an undertaking, carrying on its activities in conditions of free competition. That particular section is used by the court, by the European Commission now, to say that there is an EU arm's length principle, and that the Court of Justice has already accepted that there is such a principle, and that the Court of Justice has already accepted that there should be no different treatment between group companies and unrelated companies, free competition, with regard to the determination of the profit. I find that personally a little bit far stretched to count on that particular paragraph to build the entire analysis of EU arm's length principle. We could say that it's a new policy development, that's okay, but you cannot say, in my view, that that case gives the foundation for that argument, that therefore, in fact, it's not so completely novel. We have the precedent of that case on which everything is built. So this is the forum, the last one, Belgium is forum.
It's a precedent.
Yeah, whether that would be a precedent for the fact that there is an EU arm's length principle, and that therefore, for taxpayers, they could have known that that was going to be applied maybe in the future, therefore they have legitimate expectations. I think that if we look at the issue we spoke about today, about the legitimate expectation, I think this is really the only really legal question that will be relevant. Because as you can see, the Court of Justice and various taxpayers have made this particular argument before the General Court. So there will need to be a ruling on that. And then we will see in the current very, very strict interpretation, will resist, or maybe that a little bit more broader regulation will be given. I'm not the General Court, but I just wanted to share with you the arguments, and I think this is what we will see in the future as the procedural element that is relevant. in these three cases. Of course, the other one is the substantive interpretation. How should we consider whether or not it's state aid or not? That's another question, of course. Yeah? Do you have any questions? Because in the meantime, it's already 4 o'clock, so I think it's good to have a little coffee ready for all of you. Thanks for your attention. In the last half an hour, I want to focus with you briefly again on what could happen before a national force. And I also would like to think a little bit more about the calculation of the recovery amount, how we should consider that. Because I think that a big part of what I was planning to discuss now has in fact already been dealt with this morning by Karl Jurenfaas. Oh, I'm sorry. So, well, yeah, I've already done it. It's recording. Well, we have seen if a recipient of aid feels that there are exceptional circumstances granting him legitimate expectations, there are in fact two possibilities. First one is to claim these at EU level. So, like we've seen, you should go after decision of the Commission, you go to the General Court and then maybe even to the Court of Justice, but also at the national level they play a role. But there we should see that in fact we have to do with two different legal, legal problems, because one concerns the application for the annulment of the negative decision of the European Commission, and the other one concerns the implementation of the recovery decision by the national authorities. It's common to argue that there is, of course, Article 16 of the Council Regulation concerning the general principles of union law that have to be taken into consideration by the European Commission when it's making a decision. We see also more and more, because that was, I think it's interesting, there is more case law developing now at the General Court than it was in the past. For example, the ThyssenKrupp case, Alcoa case, they really are cases where those aid recipients go to the General Court to plead for legitimate expectations. And one of the reasons why this is quite recent, maybe, is that in the past there was a lot of uncertainty at which level those legitimate expectations should be claimed. There is in fact some case law, the Court of Justice, which suggested that it goes via national court all the time, and that they should give an interpretation in accordance with EU law. And that's, in that way, there was some uncertainty about that. But as we've seen this morning, that's not the case. So there is the annulment of the decision at EU level, and then you can go to a national court in the end to claim annulment of the implementation of the recovery decision. And that's, for example, the case Karna spoke about this morning. That's really the leading case. Commission versus Germany. Well, since it's an EU concept, it's still possible that you invoke national principles, as we've seen this morning, but in order to challenge the implementation of the recovery decision in national courts, you have to consider that it's an EU concept, so it should always be applied within the European context. So you cannot simply apply your more extensive national principles, because that would block the effective implementation of the recovery decisions. And well, here we see another case which, in which this is being dealt with, where it's also said that in case of doubt, you should grant, you should ask for a preliminary ruling. If we then, and I go a bit fast because Carla dealt with this already before, if we would then look at our ruling case again, what happens if a taxpayer goes challenging the implementation order in national law and wants to rely on national legitimate expectations, claiming that the ruling is completely in accordance with national tax law, and therefore it could count on the fact that it would be there would be legitimate expectations? You see that this argument is made somewhere in the literature, which of course disregards the fact that it should be EU claim based on an EU institution. And why is that then problematic? Again, because it would disregard the interests of the EU. And this, you see that in that case, which is already quite an old one. I mean, it says, well, we do have to regard national law and national principles on legitimate expectations, but the interests of the community should be fully taken into account. And therefore, you cannot invoke that argument in order to count on your tax scheme, which is being run in accordance with the national tax law. So, everything for the effectiveness of EU state aid law. And in the end, as we've seen, national courts are in the best position to examine those exceptional circumstances, but they should obtain a preliminary ruling from the Court of Justice in case the interpretation of exceptional circumstances is not clear enough. So then you have to go to ask for the interpretation, and that concerns then the validity of the recovery decision of the Commission. That's in fact what you are challenging then. I think I'm going a little bit too fast. There is, however, one important element to take into consideration, because it should always be established whether the recovery decision has become definitive. And it means that if the addressee of the state, which is a recipient, did not take proper action at EU level on the basis of the established case law of the Court of Justice, if you don't take action at EU level, you cannot try to have the same effect via the national route again. So if you are an interested party in those cases and you do not take action before the general court in order to try to obtain your general to obtain your legitimate expectations about your tax ruling, the national court cannot help you anymore. You should have gone already at the EU level. So there is no way to invoke your arguments anymore. And what would happen then? What does that imply for our cases, which is the second point that I wrote down there? I think that in the Belgian case, as I said before, since not all taxpayers went to general court to the general court to claim the annulment of the decision of the European Commission regarding the excess profit case, that those taxpayers who didn't take action, they cannot rely anymore on those legitimate expectations. They are simply out of the game, I would say. Whereas the ones who go to court do have still the possibility, of course. Then there is the case in the Netherlands where indeed we have seen that the decision is being challenged, but the taxpayer did not invoke legitimate expectations. Maybe because the lawyer said that makes no sense at all because she will never be able to obtain it. Question is, that's the first point that I raised there. Should we say that the EU institutions they should always check compliance with the general principle of EU law? So even if Starbucks does not claim to have legitimate expectations before the general court, that the general court in itself should always look at it, because it needs to have a look at Article 16 of the regulation, which claims that those general principles should be taken into consideration. I don't know. I think there are good arguments to say that they should, but I would say that as a lawyer it's always safer to make the argument, but apparently it's not necessary. Some people claim that they should, indeed, on the basis of the fact.
But there is no basis in the jurisprudence that the court
Well, I think it's still debated, as far as I understood, but it's better to be safe to be sorry than to take the artist, I would say.
Yes,
yeah,
sure.
That's for sure. Yeah. Yes. Yeah, and then there are Apple and the Fiat cases where explicit reference is made to the digital expectations, so there it will be dealt with anyway. What may be relevant is that, for example, in the Apple case, concerns actually two taxpayers, two companies, but the recovery decision is aimed at two beneficiaries, but it's also said that the Apple group should be paid. So the commission broadened their, in fact, the claim, saying those two companies should repay, but if they are unable, we make the group as a whole responsible, which would imply that other group companies who are being told to repay should also protect their rights, because if they would wait until the decision at the EU level is final, they are also too late. So that might be something to take into consideration. This is what I was planning to say about this issue at national level. Do we have any questions? Another issue that I want to raise with you concerns the calculation of the exact amount of the recovery. Because in the decision, the recovery of the European Commission, they can say very precisely you have to recover 200 million euros, that's it. Or they can say, well, we give you indications how much you should be recovering. And that's why, for example, in the Starbucks case, well, the amount is probably between 20 and 30 million. But the national authorities, who are much better able to consider the impact on national tax law, should make the exact calculation of the amount that should be repaid. And I think that this is going to be a problem in the future, because of course tax authorities will duly try to make the calculation, but I will show you there are difficulties, I think, to do so. So the taxpayer will go to the courts to claim that that calculation is not correct. So what should you do then? Because, and for example, the Mediaset case is an important example there, where the European Commission gave binding indications to the Italian authorities to calculate the amount of the recovery, and then it was up to them to calculate the exact amount. And, well, it was a very long proceeding, and one of the things that was made clear in the end by the European Court of Justice is that if the national tax authorities, of the national authorities in this case, come to the conclusion that in the end the aid granted is zero, and then it's zero, then it's not anymore to the European Commission to claim. But of course, that calculation that it's zero should be based on the instructions from the European Commission about this. And there, yeah, there will be difficulties, and actually this point has been raised by member states in the ruling cases, saying that Ireland, Belgium, Luxembourg, they say that it's very difficult to quantify the amount of the aid that was granted in those cases. But the European Commission shows no mercy there. They say, as regards the least difficulty quantifying the aid, this case, here we speak about Apple, deals with a relatively straightforward situation where a fiscal measure grants the beneficiary reduction in taxable base, and thus is cooperation tax liability. We can now identify a difficulty in determining the amount. So, good luck, you can finish your calculation. However, I think there are some difficulties. in general, so not particularly related to tax free cases, there is, for example, the question, what happens if, as a result of the change in the taxable amount in the country that we are dealing with, so for example, Netherlands recovers 20 million from Starbucks, so the taxable base in Starbucks company in the Netherlands is increased, which will have the effect that probably in the US, for example, where there is the shareholder, they will give a bigger credit to avoid double taxation. So the fact that there the amount is increased leads to a credit in the other state, which is in fact, then again, a benefit. Should we take that into consideration?
No.
Well, you say no, but it could be argued that maybe it should, and I think this is an issue that eventually will end up before one of the courts, because it should be clear. It's in fact a comparable issue which we have with fundamental freedoms. If we need to calculate whether you are treated worse, yeah, to what extent should you take into account the credit in the other state that we are dealing with? So it's a comparable issue. And that makes it also, for example, another issue which is related to here. The Netherlands pays the extra taxable amount in the Netherlands for the tax base of the Starbucks company. That could result in economic double taxation. But then the other state involved should in fact lower the taxable base. What should we do then? Is it then fair that we have this double taxation, or should those member states be speaking with each other and find a way under the various methods to relieve economic double taxation when it comes to transfer pricing and find a solution for that? And I think there will be issues in the future to deal with this.
Yeah.
Another issue is such recovery will have an impact on other, let's call it disposition. For example, the calculation of the loss carry forward, which is often another disposition, another element that can be disputed before courts, that could have an effect. So that will need to be considered how that relates to each other. Then in the tax ruling case, well, there is a particular problem how to deal with economic taxation, that's what I think. And of course, there is a big difficulty, how should we interpret that EU arm's length principle, which is still not so clear. How should national authorities deal with that when they try to make the calculation? Well, for example, with respect to the general difficulties, the Dutch Raad van State, the General Council giving advice on legitimate proposals, that they say that there is still too much uncertainty on this topic and that we should be working on that. So it's really a problem that will need to be considered. And then the question is, what can national courts do about these difficulties, given the fact that they have to deal with those indications of the European Commission? Well, this morning we already discussed this a little bit. There is this idea that there should be cooperation in good faith between national courts and the European Commission. That's laid down, for example, in the new council regulation on this change on the result of the state aid modernization plan, and there are 29 says that for the application of Article 107 and 108, the courts of the member states may ask the Commission to transmit to them information in its possession or its opinions and questions concerning the application of state aid. So, as there we see that you are encouraged, especially the courts, to obtain opinions from the European Commission. And it's even in another document which is the Commission note on the enforcement of state aid law by national courts. It's explicitly referred to that the national court may ask the Commission foreign opinion concerning the application of the rules, and there it's also particularly mentioned to concern the calculation of the recovery amount. So yeah, that would be a way to deal with it. But of course, there's the difficulty: what will the European Union value? What should you be doing with that? And therefore, in addition to that possibility, yeah, there is always the possibility to grant, to ask a question to the Court of Justice on the interpretation of this issue and how to deal with the indications of the European Commission. And there is some case law where that possibility to ask preliminary questions is highlighted by the Court of Justice. So even though there is the possibility to ask the Commission, you also always have the possibility to ask preliminary questions. And that's also clear from, again, that an ABS set case where the Court of Justice also was referring to that. Principle. So,
is there a case law about national judges asking good faith things?
Yeah, for example, the media set case, which was referred there it's really about asking questions to the European Commission, yes. Yeah. And there, as I wrote down here, paragraph 30, 32, and 36 of the judgment, I mean, so, he, for example, in the Mediaset case, it's written, thus, where the national court entertains doubts or has difficulties as regards the quantification of the amount of aid to be recovered, it remains open to it to contact the Commission for assistance in accordance with the general principle of the principle of cooperation in good faith, as it is laid down in the Commission notice on the enforcement of state aid law by the national courts. And then in the light of all the consideration, the National Court is bound by that decision. It is not, however, bound by the positions adopted by the institution for the court of the Commission in the execution of the decision. Nevertheless, the principle of cooperation of good faith, the National Court must take the statements of position into account as a factor of assessment. So it should not simply put them aside, it should take them into account. But of course, there is still a lot of room to interpret that particular issue. A good conclusion for this session. At my last slide, if you can see them at home if you like, I just wrote down a few other issues that I think could become relevant in the future. From which taxpayer are we actually recovering? Also, and that's what was written down also somewhere, what if the taxpayer changed his name in the proceedings in the period of time? So first it was company X who got the aid, now you are the court. Is that still the same then for the recovery? How should you think about that? What is the consequences of a tax ruling for other taxable years? So there is this ruling which is being valid until 2013. Then it was challenged by the Commission, but the taxpayer is still applying it in later years. Yeah, what should you do then? Is that then also a reason to stop proceedings? Well, then the issue we spoke about already a lot before. Yeah. What should you do with requests? What can a taxpayer do if he wants to be more sure about the tax ruling? Where should he go to? Could he eventually end up in one of the national courts? What happens when the tax inspector is making such a claim, as we have seen the recent question from Hogan Bos about the role of the tax inspector? Complaints from tax competitors, well, I don't think it's very likely because it's still a secret, but I can imagine that maybe somebody will start a complaint because of the ruling that is agreed upon by one of your competitors. How to deal with that? So this is something for our next conference, I would think, to speak about it. Thanks a lot for your attention and your time.